Senators, thank you for being here. I'm going to call the meeting of the New York State Senate Committee on Crime, Victims, Crime, and Corrections to order. Very pleased today to welcome a special guest to the committee, one who has been before the committee a couple of years ago. It's hard to believe it's been 3 years, Chairman, since you've been confirmed.
Four years.
2008 to 2012 is 4 years, yeah. Yes. Mm-hmm. And that, with that, I know Senator Maziarras was a key advocate of your appointment in the first place, and that the committee way back in 2008 thought very highly of your qualifications. And I particularly was impressed by the fact that for the first time we've had a sheriff now who is chairman of the Commission on Corrections, and that is something I know is an exemplary part of your record, as well as the fact that you are a member of a very important group that served our nation during the Vietnam War, and that your service is appreciated and forever, we are all forever grateful to you and for your service in the United States Army during the Vietnam conflict. We're welcomed by Senator Little, as well as Senator Little, Mrs. Thomas Beilein, who's the chairman of the Commission on Corrections. And with that, I think I'll turn this over to Senator Maziarras.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate the opportunity to be here to introduce Chairman Beilein and Commission on Corrections. I'm absolutely certain that since, as you pointed out, he's the first sheriff to head this commission, that all the sheriffs in the state of New York have been very happy.
I don't know if I do that.
That's what Pat Gallivan told me. But no, Tom, I know Tom is a former sheriff of Niagara County for many years. And did an excellent job there. He's just an excellent fit for this job. Recall the whole history of this thing, but sort of caught in between. He was nominated by Governor Spitzer, I think, like days before Governor Spitzer decides to leave Albany.
Yeah,
and then Governor Patterson sort of had to get up to speed and sort of reviewed all those nominations. It was held up for several months,
right.
But it worked out well.
Yeah. Right. No, thank you. Mr. Chairman, if you'd be so kind as to describe for the committee, and it was a request from Senator Hassel Thompson, that it would be a good idea to have Chairman of the Commission of Corrections discuss some of the issues. We would briefly discuss one of the medical records when we took up that bill a few weeks ago in committee. If you'd be so kind, Chairman, is just to discuss this informal, that I'm sure the committee members will have some questions, but if you just tell us about what you're doing and what some of the challenges with your job.
Sure. Now, as you know, we are the oversight agency for the corrections in New York State. And it's, there's a lot of jails out there. There's 63 county jails, there's 60 state prisons, there's Rikers Island, 400 police lockups, and 5 secure centers for the Office of Family and Children Services that we essentially regulate. Established the minimum standards as far as promulgating the rules and regulations on how these facilities are to operate, the standards of health care that they are to provide, primarily keeping in mind all the time health, safety, and security is our primary mission. We want to make sure the facility is secure, that the health of the inmate and staff is being addressed, and the safety of the staff and the inmates in the facilities are being addressed. So that's our primary function. To that end, there are three commissioners. There's myself, who was appointed by the governor and designated as the chairman of the commission, which I run the day-to-day nuts and bolts operation, the administrative end of the commission. There's the Medical Review Board that has an independent commissioner there, Commissioner Phyllis Harrison Ross, that does every mortality investigation, every inmate that deceases while they are in custody is reviewed by the medical. medical review board, that the healthcare is reviewed, the death is reviewed, and at times when necessary, reports are issued regarding that death or the medical care with that death, that associated with that death.
Is that review board a specific board within the commission?
Yes.
Is it a separately staffed board, or is it staffed by the commission?
There is commission staff on that board that are assigned to that board, and then the board itself is made up of volunteers.
And do those receive confirmation from this?
I believe board? Yes.
So we confirm, and they're volunteers that do this work?
They're high paid volunteers because they come from the medical community, they come from the legal community. Forensic pathologist is on that board. Forensic psychiatrist is on that board.
What type of workload do they have?
What type of
workload? How many times are they called upon to act?
Well, give you an idea, I believe there's probably 100 and some inmate deaths throughout the state every year. Now, Dr. Ross, who is employed, the head of it, reviews every one of them. The other deaths, she may assign to board members. So besides their four meetings a year, they meet every quarter, they each have assigned death cases where they review the autopsy and review some of the medical care provided. And if necessary, a lot of them, quite frankly, are aged out inmates that are die of natural causes. However, in any year, we could have anywhere from 20 to 25 suicides in custody between the DOC system and the jail system throughout the state. So those suicides are looked at individually too. And then virtually an autopsy is issued by the review board. An autopsy, by that I mean not a physical autopsy, but an autopsy of the events that happened leading up to the suicide. So it's independent. She is an independent commissioner. She issues a report. The board issues a report on the deaths. And then the commission as a whole votes on approving the minutes or approving the report of the death. So I'm saying these people are given a good portion of their time every month as volunteers to this board.
A different topic, so I Chairman Beilein, I had a question, and I know around this table, Senator Little, Senator Galavan, Senator Zoli, and myself, we represent some very rural counties. And one of the things that I see they struggle with, I know that when you were the sheriff, Niagara County built a new jail because of the overcrowding, because of the poor conditions in the old jail, and it was the right thing to do at the right time. I know some of the counties that I represent are struggling with the conditions in the jail. You know, obviously, you know, putting financial resources in particular, into a jail is not the most popular thing. Where I wanted to go with this was, is there anything that the commission could do to, and I'm not sure if it's some of the jurisdiction of the committee that permitted. It seems to me like, again, I'm going to give some examples, like Orleans, Genesee, Wyoming, Livingston are small rural counties, but they couldn't consolidate their jail services into something and do it in a more appropriate, economically appropriate fashion. Is that possible? Is that something the commission would look at or consider?
You're right, Senator. We don't really have the authority to say you have to do this. You need to regionalize. I think that's what you're talking
right.
about, regionalization. However, we have talked about regionalization, particularly in the Hudson Valley, because of the number of jails and what is going on. The difficulty in the whole concept is getting two counties to agree on what they want. Right now, to throw it out there, we have Schoharie County, who lost their jail during the hurricane. We have Greene County right next door, whose jail is over 120 years old. It's in dire straits. And we met with the Schoharie County officials and saying, you know, you have to do this. As legislators, as leaders of your county, reach out to Green. And, but it doesn't seem to be, you know, if I have a good jail and it's up to date, I don't want the problems.
So the commission has no jurisdiction over that anymore?
No. We can encourage it.
See, it just doesn't, and you are aware, and I know that Senator Galvin would be aware of, you know, that every time I drive down the thruway, I think about this. The federal government just built a new jail right at exit 48 on the thruway, which is right down the road from the Orleans County facility, which is right down the road from the Genesee County facility. It just seemed to me, like from an economic standpoint, it could have been, you know, well, because Orleans is being told that they have to pay to invest into their jail.
I have worked with Orleans County. They're doing some very needed structural improvements to their jail, which will probably alleviate them having to invest in a new facility. They're, you know, they had to put a roof on, they don't have water. But they're doing that.
And I think Genesee has some issues too.
Genesee is an older jail, but you speak about a lot of these counties have figured out ways to regionalize by boarding out inmates. I think Orleans County takes all of Genesee's female inmates. So they've figured out ways to do it.
Do counties have to receive the commission's permission to do that sort of boarding? Or do you oversee any of that?
Yeah, we have to issue a substitute jail order for each inmate.
Whenever there's a boarding issue.
When there's a boarding issue.
A boarding question. Register that.
Yeah, we have to approve it. We look at the capacity of the jail that's going to board them in. See if they have room for it. And then I probably sign 500 substitute jail orders a month, allowing inmates to board out in other facilities.
Senator Little.
Yeah, on that. Same thing. I've talked to you before. I'm trying to get a couple of my counties to work together. I have six counties. Hamilton only has six cells, and that's more than enough. But the other five have all had to build new facilities and add on, and you know they were going to all board in all those inmates from all those other counties, which have all disappeared. And they're scrambling for trying to get federal inmates rather than. But they're always complaining about the demands upon them for staffing, and if they have a wing for the under 21, 18 to 21, and they're only three, they still have to staff as if it was totally full, is what they're telling me. And I'm wondering if there's something that can be done with the categories in these small jails. They don't need to separate the under 21 and all that. There's a lot of supervision. It's not a massive jail. Somehow we've got to do something to help them with the staffing mandates.
Well, I guess there's two parts to this question. The first is classification. You know, it's the correction law that 16, 17, 18-year-olds must be segregated. So that's the law, and we have to abide by the law until that is changed. Now, a county can apply for an emergency variance three times a year to be able to commingle younger inmates with older inmates.
Based upon being overcrowded or something?
Summer months, they get up there. They can apply for a variance to go ahead and commingle inmates. The other issue on staffing is, probably Franklin County is probably the one you hear from, because that's the one I hear from.
Yeah.
I would say to you that 9 times out of 10, professional administrator of the jail, the sheriff, and the commission are on the same page with staffing. We have no issues with our staffing analysis, but the county legislator or the county executive usually does.
Well, they're the ones that control the budget and tax the taxpayers.
Right.
But and it seems like in many cases it's, you know, it's kind of a waste of money. There must be a more efficient way, even a more efficient way than having to have individual waivers for 500. To go to another jail. I mean, I tried to get more into Washington County, one to take the women, one to take the young. And like you said, it's, you run into a lot of other issues there as it gets along with them.
But very, very rarely is the sheriff and correction, or the commission on separate pages when it comes to staffing. It's usually an issue with the county executives, and you're right, they're paying the bill, and it's...
Right, and the correction officers don't want to change anything.
Well, and, but you're looking at, you know, the professional, the sheriff that's in there, saying this is how much staff we need, you're looking at jail administrators saying, and you're looking at our independent agency going in and sitting down and going through that jail, post by post, with the sheriff, and coming to what we believe is a safe staffing level before we issue a staffing analysis.
Do you have any more instances in the state facilities of altercations and violence in the state facilities?
I would say it's static. You know, I reviewed their inmate on inmate assaults, their inmate on staff assaults, which they put out weekly, and it's been static for 4 years.
It doesn't change much.
No.
Senator Galvin.
Chairman, welcome, and I guess I'd be remiss if I didn't comment on our relationship. We both served the sheriffs and neighbor counties together, and you preceded me. Taller, older, I have more hair. and of course, I really appreciate your friendship and your professionalism and helping me out over the years. So I concur with the chairman and the senator that you're very well placed in this position. I have questions in two areas. The first has to do with, we passed a law last year to allow local facilities to house out-of-state inmates. My information is several months old, so this may already be implemented. But I've gotten calls from a couple different sheriff's offices around December, January, and they had indicated, talking with the commission, talking with the council, that they couldn't do it yet, just waiting for mission to come up with regulations, and it was relayed that the commission isn't going to get to it for a while, and I'm just wondering what the status of that is.
The regulations are posted.
Okay, so I'm a few months behind. So, yeah, they're posted, so they can go ahead now.
Yeah, without making excuses, right during that time we were involved in the restacking effort and all our
I'm a few months old, and I'm just happy to hear that it's
coming. Yeah, they're posted now, and the only county out there right now that has inquired is Albany County. And I think they're looking to go in the direction of Vermont and taking it.
Yeah, and interestingly enough, that was not one of the counties. It was a North Country and then a border. But moving on, can you just talk about the issue of double bunking, two inmates in a cell, and talk about it both as it relates to docs and the local correctional facilities? Is it philosophy in general looking at it, and then do the same standards apply between state and local, and even at the state level from state prison to state prison?
Yeah. I think what you look at, what I go to on this, and let me say that I don't believe that double bunking is right in every situation. However, I do believe that there are situations where double bunking is perfectly acceptable. So it's not like one rule or one size fits all. But if you go with the American Correctional Association standards on double bunking, which calls for a certain square foot cell, otherwise you don't put two inmates in 60 square feet. I believe the ACA is, you know, you need at least an 80 square foot cell. And that's
for inmate for double bunking.
For double bunking. They actually have a formula that is so many square feet, unfettered square feet. You got to take the toilet out, you got to take the bed out per inmate. And then it also has the amount of time that the inmate can stay double bunked. And usually it's in the jail setting, it's 10 hours. Otherwise, you can lock them in together, but you know, somewhere within no longer than one 10-hour period a day, and meet those requirements as far as square feet is concerned. Now, you have to remember now that at 10 hours, they're gonna leave that cell and be out in the day space, whether it's a pad, whether it's a catwalk or a prisoner walk, someplace where there is other people, people to associate with and to, you know, get away from the same person. I have no problem with double bunking under those scenarios. Double bunking where you would go less than those square feet. Double bunking where you would go more than those 10 hours, I think can be problematic. I think that at some point, the dominant inmate ends up, you know, running the show in there, and that problems can exist. But other than, and that is my feelings both with county jails and with docs.
For the county jails, if I remember right, you had to issue variances for the county jails to double bunk.
And some double bunking situation will let them go under the state. And the rule is in here that we're changing it to go with the ACA standard. The state demands 100 square foot. We are in the process of changing that to be in conformance with the American Correctional Association standard of 80 square feet.
Do you issue the variances for all the state correctional facilities, or is that something that the commissioner of DACS controls in his
own? It depends on the capacity. We would issue a variance on the capacity.
And I must tell you that your predecessor, you're exempt from this issue. The Commissioner of Corrections came through, and again, the prior team before Commissioner Beline took over, and granted all these variances for the state facilities that I believe was unconscionable at the time. It was a blanket allowing of double bunking in our state facilities. It was one of those things when it was slipped through, that I, it was a prior, two prior gubernatorial administrations ago, and it was one of those things that was done in the cloak of night, and this committee was not given any kind of input or oversight doing those variances. I asked the then chairman of the commission, how could you do such a thing? Frankly, it was a way to forestall the requirement that New York build more correctional facilities by just simply granting these variances. You don't have to comment on this, Commissioner. It was not under your watch, and it's not under this administration. But nonetheless, it has an impact by those facilities that we all represent that are double-bunked at the state level.
And of course it gets to, I mean, common to it in your three areas, the safety and security, right? The inmates and staff.
And there's double-bunking situations where it's dormitory double-bunking. Otherwise, a room like this, you put four bunks in here. I don't see that as the issue, as putting two inmates in a cell.
And that's
for an extended period of time.
Yeah, I'd have to ask, why do we continue to allow like an upstate correctional, which is a maxi, two in a cell for 24 hours a day?
I can address that issue.
Yeah. Are the waivers forever, or do
It was built. Unless you want to take this.
I'll let you.
it's a tough one. It was the way the two new correctional facilities that were built, the Maxis, both of those were built upstate at Five Points, were built with, it wasn't double bunking, they built them to house two inmates in a cell. As opposed to Auburn and Attica, which were never built for two inmates to be in a cell. Upstate was built that way, as was Five Points.
And they had murdered one show for the other one at upstate before anybody could get to the cell. But I look at that and I just think, where's the Human Rights Council?
Well, it was a lockdown facility, and it was built for that purpose. Five Points was built for more programs, but still the real tension becomes when a cell was built for one person, and there are two people placed in that cell.
These aren't terribly big cells. I don't know my square footage very well, but...
Before the chairman has to go, I just wanted to mention for our New York City colleagues something that the chairman told me earlier that I was very surprised at the situation at Rikers. Could you explain that?
The senator mentioned to me that he was under the impression that Rikers was overcrowded. And capacity-wise, Rikers is not overcrowded. I believe that when I became commissioner in 2008, and this is anecdotal because I'm just coming off the top of my head with these figures, but the population of Rikers was 16,000 inmates. And I believe that is like maybe 12 to 13,000 inmates today. So, you know, as far as capacity issues at Rikers, you know, it's not as dire as it was, say, 10 or 12 years ago, where Rikers was, you know, at capacity or above capacity. In fact, Rikers has stepped up to the plate several times and have boarded in inmates from Suffolk and Nassau County when needed. Yes.
Questions? With that, hearing done, Chairman, thank you very much for your involvement, for your very helpful comments today. And we appreciate the job you do and wish you all the best in continuing that responsibility.
All right, thank you.
There was one question. I'm sorry. You started talking about the fact that there were three positions and you took questions you did not finish, and I really would like you to finish that.
The other commission is the grievance. The inmate grievance is the citizens' policy and complaint review committee. At this particular time, that commissioner is vacant right now. I have been filling in as the chairman of that committee. We receive approximately 130 to 150 inmate grievances every month.
I receive as many as you do. No, I'm serious about that.
The grievances are reviewed first by staff to see how valid the grievances are. They reach out and they investigate the grievances. Then the grievances are whittled down to the ones that we believe should be accepted or needed to be denied, but we need to make a comment to the jail administration about practices. There's a committee, again, made up similar to the medical review board that are volunteers that meet once a month. They actually meet more than once a month because they each get a packet depending on alphabetical order of jails that they review those grievances. And these are just citizens that volunteer for this committee. And then they either decide we deny the grievances or we accept the grievances.
Are you accepting recommendations for that commission, for that vacancy?
That would come through the governor.
Good. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, thank you very much for your time, your service, and appreciate the input today.
Okay.
We have just five measures. We have five measures before the committee. 1861 by Senator LaValle amends the executive law relating to time which consideration shall be determined for parole. Motion to report. Negative votes.
Question, sir.
Set question.
First of all, what is the reasoning behind this bill? If I understand it correctly, if somebody is turned down for parole currently, they have to wait 24 months to be reconsidered. This would take it from 2 years to 5 years. What is the reasoning for that?
Counsel?
It doesn't require a 5 year square. It just says the next year it can't be up to 60 months.
It doesn't change my question. What is the reason?
According to the bill memo, it's just currently the parole board members, there are some crimes that are so heinous, or some inmates that are so uncooperative that you kind of know they're not going to get out in 2 years. that. I think it's based after they have the interview and the board meets on the Thursday. Make the determination as to when your next peer is going to be.
Put yourself in the place of a victim. Every time your wife's murderer is up for parole, you have to go and make the kind of statements that you believe necessary to be made, the kind of transactions that the input, those kinds of concerns. This provides the discretion of the parole board to say, well, we just tried that, basically, and it was brought a lot of evidence to board. We don't want to put the victim's family through that again. We'd like to be able to have the discretion to extend the period. It's not mandatory. It provides, where there's in effect a notorious case in particular, we're just having one now in the Southern Tier, an individual who, a young kid, basically, who murdered someone. Again, having the family regurgitate that type of grief is something that this seeks to avoid.
Well, I can certainly understand that. It seems that does it establish parameters as far as that discretion?
Whatever the discretion is now will continue. In other words, currently they consider whatever standards are used now to determine whether inmate A is going to get a rehearing in 1 year and inmate B is going to get a rehearing in 2 years, those standards will be the same.
And how is that determined? Does that have to be unanimous? Does everybody have to agree in the room? It's like
not currently. Now it's a majority vote.
What if there's two people in the room?
Then they would, if they disagreed,
yeah,
then that inmate would, there'd be no decision. The inmate would come back the next month. Before a new panel, yes.
If I'm speaking, for example, about the parole board hearing that I went to a couple of months ago, so there were only two parole board members there. If they had decided this person would not be up for parole, so they both decided to decline the parole, then they would have to have another discussion about when this person would be up for parole again?
Yes.
Okay. And then when that discussion happens, if there's no agreement between the two members of the parole board, then the decision to not parole them is then pushed aside, dismissed, and then there's another.
Well, that's an interesting. I was on the parole board for 5 years.
Yeah.
There was disagreement on whether to, amongst commissioners, a discussion whether or not to deny parole or permit parole.
Right.
And there was occasions that I was on two member panels where there was disagreement, so it was put off to the next month.
Right.
There was also disagreement on the length of time, but in all cases, my personal experience,
yep,
the length of the hold was always, it was ultimately resolved in the discussions amongst the commissioners. So I don't know the answer to your question because I never experienced that. We started out disagreeing. One might say 6 months, one might say 18 months. But in the end, they came together on a decision as far as when the next hearing would be. I'm sorry, when they'd be eligible again for parole.
Was that determined at that point, right? At the same
yes.
time you deny?
Yes. Yes. Essentially, they're denying and then they're deciding how long they have to stay in there before they come back before the parole board. So it's all part of the same decision.
But it seems to me that they're basically punishing them at that point. And if we allow for discretion for up to 5 years, like somebody could then be, oh, we're not going to see you for another 5 years. So you get another 5 years inside.
I guess one could look at it that they're punishing them, but the other way could be looked at, it's that's the law, and it's the parole commissioners. They're charged with the responsibility to approve release or deny release. And then the law says if they deny the release, then they have to set the date no later than 24 months from that time when the inmate comes back before the board again.
Senator Hassel Thompson.
Yeah. The question that I have is that you were reading the justification solely, you would understand the necessity. But there's nothing in the language of the bill that speaks to the type of crimes.
Yeah.
And so that's the part that disturbs me greatly. If it were to set out a certain, if it would set out the language in the way that the justification in the bill memo does, then I might feel more comfortable. But this could be any crime, and so I'm not comfortable voting for this.
Motion to report, 1861, negative votes. Senator Hassel Thompson, Senator Rivera.
Without record.
Motion passes. 1985, Senator Golden, relating to crime victims emergency awards. Motion to report. Negative votes. Question. Question, Senator Hassel Thompson.
Just explain just a little bit to me what these limitations. I'm not sure that I understand this, Judge.
Currently, crime office of victim services is now for a crime victim can make an emergency award to a crime victim.
Right.
Maximum of $2,500. This would to replace emergency medical equipment that is necessary for the victim's continued survival. They can exceed the $2,500 cap. If someone has,
oxygen,
that type of stuff that gets destroyed and grinding them up and things are stolen, they have to replace those. And they cost more than $2,500 just for authorization
to expend more
for that.
For emergency medical equipment. Motion report, negative votes, bills reported. 4160A by Senator Civito amends the executive law and the criminal procedure law, enabling victims to view parole hearings via closed-circuit television or on a website.
Question. There's a couple of questions out here. One, it doesn't establish what the fiscal impact would be to determine for the creation of the system, whatever it would be. And second, the purpose of this is to allow victims to be able to look into basically what I did the other day, what I did a couple months ago when I visited a parole board hearing. So it would be the same thing, except they would be able to do it remotely. Okay, and they wouldn't be privy to the deliberation, right?
No, this is my understanding is this would allow the crime victims to view the parole hearing itself. I believe that the remote access goes off when the commissioners
after the deliberation decide. And what is the purpose? I'm trying to
transparency. I think the big thing it can give the victim in terms of the ability to view these hearings. You got a chance to look at them because you're a state senator and you went to the facility. All victims don't have that kind of access. Hopefully they'd have that kind of access to the appropriate website and the like. Motion report. Negative votes. Bills reported. 4805 by Senator Flanagan amends the executive law, the criminal procedure law. Motion to report. Negative votes. Senator Rivera, the negative. Senator Hassel Thompson and Senator Rivera, the negative. Lastly, Senator Ball's measure to amend the executive law, extending the period of time between parole eligibility for certain inmates. Motion to report. Negative votes. Senator Rivera, Senator Hassel Thompson, and the negative. Without rec. For Senator Galvin and Senator Little. Thank you very much. We asked Commissioner Green to be here today. He could not be. In heading of Criminal Justice Services, hopefully in one of our future meetings, he'll be able to come. Thank you very much.
Do you know how many more meetings we're going to have here?